Well, I think sometimes perhaps you have to wait, sadly, for a generation to die.
She is one of Australia's most successful Indigenous filmmakers. And frankly, she's just one of Australia's most successful filmmakers on both the big screen and small. Rachel Perkins was the brains behind the musical Brand New Day, Mabo. Her company, Blackfella Films, have made documentaries like First Australians and First Contact. The daughter of iconic Indigenous activist Charlie Perkins has also actively been fighting to have the nation's first people recognised in the Australian Constitution. And she's also taken on the beloved Australian book, Jasper Jones. Now a funny, dark murder mystery movie set in Western Australia in the racially charged dying days of the 1960s.
Thanks so much for talking to us.
Oh, my pleasure.
They're very formal.
Our challenge will be that it all has to be shot in the same light.
Cut!
So, why Jasper Jones?
Well, it's just a great story, you know, essentially. It's I read it a couple of years ago and someone had said to me, oh, this will be a great story, you should adapt it. And I was like, oh yeah, what would you know?
So which I assume is your reaction to most of these things.
Oh, no, but it was my partner at the time. I was like, yeah, what would you know? Anyway, so, you know, it has great elements. It's got the murder mystery, which is the great hook, but it's also got the beautiful humour of those characters and that great dialogue, which is, you know, laugh out loud, hilarious. You know, that combination of different tones is something I always like. It's really hard, I think, to have multiple tones going in the same thing. And of course, the social commentary resonated with me, and so on a lot of levels.
Yeah, I was going to say, there's a sort of the contours of the times, the late 60s is really interesting in terms of what's going on.
Yeah.
Are you comfortable with the notion of you being regarded as a political filmmaker? Because I think there's a certain sense of you out there that between your television work and your film work, that you deal with that.
Yeah.
Are you comfortable with it?
Yeah, I am. Our films definitely are ambassadors for our nation. That's what you get to understand. Like, people understand Australia through our filmmaking.
Yeah.
And that's when you realise how powerful filmmaking is, because it can frame a nation, or it can frame a national narrative in the way that films like Peter Weir's Gallipoli framed that legend, you know? I mean, what's actually surprising me, I've just made a film for constitutional recognition. Mm. So it's just a little in-house film for people to watch. But it's 200 years in, like, 30 minutes.
Yeah.
And what was really happening is we had a group of people in this country who were living at extreme disadvantage, who were second-class citizens to the white people in this country.
What I took away from making that was the resilience of people to continue knowing failure was likely. Mm. And I think, you know, in over five decades, to continue to have hope and reserve cynicism is a really exemplary thing.
Why do you think they did?
Because they knew that they had to change the world. It was otherwise people literally would die and suffer.
Yeah. If you could change anything about the way we talk about constitutional recognition, or as people calling for a treaty and things like that, if you could change anything about that conversation on a national level, what would you change?
Well, look, actually, I think it's... I am losing hope that we will get there with the whole constitutional reform process, because I think that Australia won't allow itself to acknowledge the place of Indigenous people in this country. There's something fundamental that we don't see Aboriginal people as truly Australian.
And why do you think that is?
Because our narrative, our Australian narrative, has been built on, you know, the Anglo-British settlement narrative. Mm. And, you know, our education system has been based on that narrative, our filmmaking has been based on that narrative. That's the story that, you know, the country has created, this young nation. So, yeah, it's odd to be sort of think about Indigenous people as outside of that narrative, because, of course, they are truly Australian. Mm. So,
and it's not a young country, is it?
No.
If you were sitting in front of a person who did hold that view, that Indigenous Australians aren't really Australians and it began with colonisation, how would you go about changing their minds?
I would take that person and I would say, come with me to Central Australia and camp out in the bush with me and listen to the languages of this country and go right out into the middle of the landscape. Put yourself in it and imagine, you know, 2,500 generations, 52,000 years of civilization. There's a depth to that. There's an ancientness in the country that people are missing, that they don't have the opportunity to connect to. I have lots of people who have that view around me all the time, and I just think perhaps you have to wait, sadly, for a generation to die, if you want to be really blunt about it. There's like this psychological shift that the nation has to make, and I don't think it's going to yet.
How do you change that? Because it strikes me that your work, particularly First Australians and also First Contact, are really very different ways of addressing perception.
Mm. Yes, well, I think that's, you know, why film is so powerful. Yeah. You know, it can't change the world, but it can change hearts and minds, and it can change them en masse.
Mm. This is probably the worst toilet in Australia.
What do you say to criticism that came from inside and outside of Indigenous Australia about First Contact being basically Indigenous
disadvantaged? Poverty porn. Yeah. So there were three people who wrote that.
Yeah.
And I can name them all and you probably know them. They were young Indigenous people who were giving a view about how other Aboriginal people should present themselves. Mm. So those Aboriginal people in the series, they had seen the first series. Mm. They knew absolutely who was going to be there. They knew potentially what these people were going to say to them. Mm. And they had made a choice to tell their story to those people, and that is their right. So if a young person says to me, that was not right that you made that 75-year-old lady recount the traumatic experience of being removed from her family, I'm like, well, who are you to tell her how to deal with her trauma? People might say, oh, we shouldn't show poor housing, poverty porn. Well, you go live up there in those communities like my family does, and they do live in poverty. Mm. And they do have those conditions. And they want First Contact, that show, to give them exposure so that maybe the area like Barkly Shire does something about their housing. It's like, who the hell's got the right to tell anybody else how to deal with their stuff? That's their right.
Rachel Perkins, it's really lovely talking to you.
Yeah, thanks.
We covered some stuff, didn't we?